an excuse to steal. That's how former Senator Richard Gordon described the use of confidential funds of civilian agencies. He's also calling for an audit on how local governments spend their secret funds.
Our civilian agencies, like the Secretary of Education, I can understand the ICT against cybercrime, give them something. But you know, the police also have a cyber unit, and confidential funds, let's face it, is really an excuse to steal. It is the National Steel Corporation. But what is unacceptable is now local governments, and pardon me, local governments are getting tremendous amounts of federalism. Well, sa Davao, you know, they're getting half a billion in intelligence funds. They have to account for that.
Gordon, meanwhile, lauds House leaders for pushing back against former President Rodrigo Duterte's recent Thai raids. See, Duterte earlier called the House of Representatives the most rotten government institution. He's also alleged to have threatened Minority Leader Franz Castro for pushing for the realignment of confidential funds.
We have to speak out, all right? Second, when a former president threatens a congressman and says, you're the one that that must be killed. If I were my, I will kill you. You know, you cannot allow this constant barrage of flippant statements, according to him, it's flippant. In law, that's grave threats. He can be prosecuted now. He's not the president anymore. It's impunity. And to my mind, they cannot get away with it.
Hackers once again attempted to break their way into the online system of yet another government institution. This time it's the Philippine Senate, which recorded a spike in attacks on its website the same day the House of Representatives website was defaced. The Senate says its tech team is on top of the situation and constantly monitoring any further attacks. A number of government agencies have fallen victim to hackers in recent weeks. These include the Philippine Statistics Authority, PhilHealth, and the Science and Technology Department. Another student dies due to alleged hazing. The latest victim of this fraternity ritual was a criminology student. Liza Aquino tells us more.
A criminology student suspected to be the latest victim of hazing died in a hospital in Manila yesterday evening. The bereaved family identified the victim as Aldrin Levy Bravante, 25 years old. According to Alexander Bravante, the father of the victim, Aldrin was last seen by his family in their home in Imus, Cavite last Sunday. But Aldrin went back to his school in Quezon City yesterday morning. Initial investigation from authorities say that the initiation rites was conducted in an abandoned building in Barangay Santo Domingo in Quezon City around 12 noon yesterday, and it lasted for 2 hours. Aldrin allegedly passed out due to his injuries at around 4 p.m. and was rushed to the hospital by two of the suspects involved in the hazing. He unfortunately was declared dead by doctors at around 6:45 in the evening. The individuals who brought him to the hospital were immediately arrested by police officers from Manila Police District after receiving a call from the hospital, and they were then turned over to the Quezon City Police District. Initial medical results states that the victim sustained injuries in his arms and feet, burn marks in different parts of his body, and bruises in his thighs. According to Quezon City spokesperson Police Lieutenant Colonel May Henyo, the police is still looking for the paddle that the suspects used in the initiation rites. The family, along with the school's representative, went to the hazing site earlier this morning, where they also found the motorcycle of the victim. They're calling for justice for their loved one.
Babayad niya lang po ng tuition at padala mama niya. So, wala. Talagang wala na, oh. Matigas na eh. Noong dinala daw sa hospital, matigas na eh. Pwede ibig sabihin na pinatay na nila anak ko. Justisya lang po. Dahil yung lahat ng gagastusin ng anak ko, dapat gawin nila. At saka makulong sila.
Aside from the two suspects that were initially arrested by the police, another two of the suspects surrendered in CIDU office in Camp Caringal in Quezon City. Now, the police are still searching for the other suspects involved in the initiation rites. And currently, the four suspects are here and will face charges for a violation of anti-hazing law of 2018.
Two prosecution witnesses in the remaining drug case, so former Philippine Senator Laila Dirima, are said to be willing to recant their testimonies. Rodolfo Magleo and Nonilo Arile reportedly expressed their intention in a letter to Dirima. Magleo and Arile had previously accused her of receiving drug money to found this former senator's senatorial campaign. De Lima's lawyer, Dino De Leon, says the two men admitted their statements against De Lima have bothered their conscience. They also claim five other witnesses will recant their statements against the former senator. De Lima has been jailed since 2016 on drug charges, two of which have already been dismissed. Philippine authorities urged to rescue children in Socorro Town in Surigao del Norte after the discovery of dozens of tombs of infants in the area. Nico Bawa also tells us the local cult known as the Socorro Group now reportedly being affected by infighting.
When the news team first met Lovely Sabandal, she narrated how she, her brother, and children escaped from Socorro Bayanihan Services. She testified in the Senate against SBSI leader Senor Aguila. She says her family is a victim of forced marriages and the lack of food and education for the children.
Kahit isang taon na kaming bumaba, please ko pa po lahat, sir. At hindi pa po bumabalik yung dating buhay namin. At saka malaki pong damage sa tipid. Ito na nangyari sa pangalan kong anak kasi 11 years old na po siya ngayon. Yan po yung naging depression ko nang muntik na pumawala ako sa tamang pag-iisip kasi sinisisi ko po yung sarili ko.
Her mother, Nenita, and three siblings who are still members of SBSI were furious that Lovely testified against Aguila, especially since one sibling is an official of SBSI.
Kung may masakit sa amin, example, ang aking husband, siya ang pumalit ng medisina, sir. Bakit ano pang gagawin? Bakit anong question nga si senior mabait?
On Sunday afternoon, Lovely and the other witnesses boarded an army truck accompanied by soldiers. They have not visited their loved ones in the SBSI cemetery ever since they left the group. The group's security tailed the witnesses and followed Lovely's group to the cemetery. After lighting a candle on their father's grave, Lovely's brother came. He blames their father's death on Lovely's departure from SBSI. Nenita also arrived in the cemetery. Lovely claimed that her family did not inform her of her father's death because of her testimony.
Tingin niyo po ba maayos pa ito?
Gusto ko sir nga maayos pero hindi na kaya nila. Isigalit na galit sila, ha?
Nenita apologized and explained to her daughter that she did not deliberately hide her husband's death.
Ay, musultihan!
Pamati, mukuntak mo. Pero sa panahon, si tatay nga naglubog na, wami ninyo pahibaw.
Ah, magsayot mo mo pa sila.
Sa naho, si nagkakapihan, nag-ingo na ho, nga, imo tatay gida, nagmisa mo.
Nenita added that it was her husband's dying wish for their family to reconcile.
Kasi, ina ko, sir. Ang ina, mas... Ma, ang ina, dali lang magkuha ng pasaylo sa
alin lang mapatawad.
Magpatawad.
I-set aside na lang yung mga issue between sa aming mga paniniwala kasi iba na yung paniniwala namin, hindi nakatulad sa kanila dati. O i-set aside na lang kasi pamilya kami. Kahit anong mangyari, magkadugo kami. Kahit anong mangyari, walang ibang tutulong sa amin. Kami lang yung magkakapami.
The siblings may face each other again in the succeeding hearings, but they say they will no longer try to convince each other to change their testimonies. Meanwhile, Senator Ronald De La Rosa is convinced that the DSWD has to rescue the children in SBSI after he inspected the area and talked to SBSI officials.
Yung pagpapakasal sa mga anak, hindi nagreklamo yung mga parents, ha? Granting na inosyente yung mga bata, walang alam. Pero yung parents, nandun ang mga parents, my God, nandun ang mga parents. Hinahayaan lang nila, tapos forced sex pa.
De La Rosa says, it's alarming that parents are simply following the orders of Senor Aguila and the SBSI officials. He also wants the NBI and PNP to investigate the more than 20 babies and toddlers who died while living in the SBSI community. Nico Bawa, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Pol Pati and different sectors in Zamboanga ink a covenant to ensure a peaceful conduct of the upcoming village and youth council elections. Queenie Casimiro now joins us with that story. Queenie, over to you.
Yes, Carmina. Authorities in Zamboanga Peninsula are gearing up for the forthcoming Barangay and SK elections. The Commission on Elections spearheaded on Monday the commitment signing for a peaceful and orderly elections in Region 9. Different sectors were present during the activity held at the Police Regional Office 9 in Camp Abandan here in Zamboanga City. COMELEC Chairperson George Irwin Garcia expressed his gratitude to the security sector for ensuring a peaceful filing of certificates of candidacy. He appealed that similar effort be exerted by the police and other government forces as the campaign period is set to start on October 19 until the 20th. Garcia says there has been no complaint so far against the checkpoints being initiated by the authorities in implementation of the election gun ban. Garcia stressed 762,000 vacant positions will be filled in the forthcoming political exercise with over a million candidates who are vying for the different electoral posts. He called on voters to make an informed choice and not be swayed by monetary amounts or favors, possibly being given by some of the candidates to their constituents. Garcia added most of the problems within the families and communities are being brought to the barangay, which makes it imperative for the voting public to choose qualified and efficient local officials to attend to these problems. Garcia also called on the candidates to abide by the rule of law and ensure a peaceful, truthful, and orderly elections on October 30. For ANC, Queenie Casimiro, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Poll Body holds its first hearing on a petition to disqualify Smartmatic from participating in the procurement process for the 2025 elections. Our very own Victoria Tulat now joins us with details. Victoria, over to you.
Carmina, because of alleged irregularities in the 2022 national elections, the group of former DICT Secretary Eliseo Rio Jr. and former COMELEC Commissioner Augusto Lagman is asking the Commission on Elections to not allow elections technology company Smartmatic from possibly participating in the procurement process for the 2025 election. In the first hearing on the petition today, petitioners alleged that Smartmatic was not able to meet minimum standards as required in their contract. Smartmatic supplied the vote counting machines used in the 2022 automated election. One of the many allegations is that 32 election returns were transmitted to COMELEC's transparency server even before the VCMs started transmitting. Petitioners also raised the possibility of fraud since 20,300 modems used just one IP or internet protocol address. The petitioners clarified that they are not questioning the results of the 2022 elections, just Smartmatic's qualification. The camp of Smartmatic answered the allegations one by one. According to the company's counsel, the time of transmission of election returns through the transparency server is reflected in the ninth copy of the election receipt. He said petitioners might have used the time on the first eight copies, which is why they assumed that ERs were transmitted earlier. As for the IP address, Smartmatic said there is no irregularity with using one IP address since the unofficial parallel count made by election watchdog PPCRB matched with the final election results. The COMELEC NBank, particularly Commissioner Ernesto Masada Jr., questioned the petitioners if their prayer to disqualify Smartmatic is not premature since the procurement process has not yet started. The camp of the petitioners said they are taking on a preemptive approach with their action since Smartmatic may opt to bid. COMELEC Chairman George Garcia asked the petitioners if they are amenable to open 10 selected ballot boxes from different areas of the country to settle the issue once and for all. The petitioners said they agree to this. COMELEC NBank will discuss the suggestion. After this, the hearing was ended before 12 noon and both camps were ordered to submit additional documents.